Hi everybody, welcome to MST Conversation. My name is Seema and as you know, we are having the Valentine's campaign at MST. And to talk on the same, today we are talking about conflict resolution in couples. And we have a relationship counselor who's an expert in this field. Her name is Rajika and she's also a partner at MST. And today we'll be talking about conflict resolution in couples. Hi Rajika, welcome on board.
Hi, Seema. Thank you.
How are you? How have you been?
I am great. Thank you. Surviving the pandemic.
That's true. That's true for a lot of people. So, as you know, we are talking about conflict resolution couples, and you've been working in the field of relationship counseling. How would you want to talk about that? How would you want to introduce yourself and your work with, you know, relationship counseling in couples?
Yeah, so as you said, I have been working with couples for a very long time now.
Yeah,
I do relationship counseling. I do not just between two people, but also family counseling, marriage counseling, premarital counseling. So that is usually what I work with. And this is the first time, and some people might have seen me hosting for Mental Health Today, but this is the first time I'm on the other side. And I'll be giving a little bit of, sharing a little bit of my knowledge. So I'm very excited for that.
Yeah, that's great. And, you know, we are discussing something that is so prevalent amongst couples, which is conflict. I mean, do log saath rahenge, so of course, there's going to be some argument, some disagreement. That's so natural to happen. So what, how would you define a conflict? Because kabhi kabhi it's going to be a small argument, but how would you define what conflict is actually?
So, I think for the course of this conversation, we're going to be referring
to couples.
The conflict between two couples, okay, because it is a Valentine's special, episode. But for whoever is listening to this, feel free to, you know, take it to other relationships in your life as well.
Okay.
Something might just fit.
Yeah.
And relationships are pretty similar in most of the areas. And the issues also that come up are quite similar to one another. So, but for the course of this relationship, I'll be referring to couples, be it either married or engaged or dating in those lines in a relationship. So, I think Seema, I didn't want to, tell you what a conflict is. There is this very famous psychologist and somebody who I personally follow called Dr. William Glasser. And he was the one who came up with choice theory. So, he said that there are seven deadly habits which can put an end to any relationship. Okay, first is criticizing, blaming, complaining, nagging, threatening, punishing, and bribing. So these seven, when happen together or in individuality, kind of come out to what a conflict is between two people. So, you know, it can be disagreements between people, it can be fights. It can be, I know this, you don't know that, being the superior, trying to be the superior person in the relationship. It can be individuality that, you know, we don't have to do everything together and I want to be alone and give me my space, something like that. It can also be a little bit about upbringing, you know, how we India comes from a very big cultural, background. So, and different people have different cultures and different upbringings. And, you know, something that is very common in one culture might not be very common in another culture. So those issues, plus the values and beliefs that the people who are in a relationship bring to the relationship. You know, for somebody, you know, I just had a very recent case where I was just working with this new couple. They just started dating. And the girl says that he is very controlling and he doesn't like me going out at night. And even when I have to work, he doesn't allow it.
Mm-hmm.
So the question was on how is he giving himself the power to allow something like this to happen? And the boy, on the other hand, says that this is how it is. Women in my house do not step out of the house after 8 o'clock. So, it is not his fault. This is what he comes through. And this is not the girl's fault as well, because this is what she doesn't believe in. So, a combination of all of this, so disagreements, fights, individuality, upbringing, plus the seven deadly habits, criticizing, blaming, complaining, nagging, threatening, punishing, and bribing. Together is what I would say is a conflict between two people.
Yeah, and that's very nicely explained. Now people, watching, especially couples, if you're doing that, have acknowledge it and probably try to, try some other habits. There are so many. So as we have understood about conflict, it's also true that sometimes conflict causes a lot of problems in a relationship, and not just in terms of family settings. It also kind of creates probably mental health issues, psychological issues. So how would you want, like, it'd be great if you can put a little bit of light on that. How does that, how conflicts amongst two people, especially couples, what problems do they face in these areas?
I think there are tremendous impacts of conflict between two people, around to the people around them, to the family, to the friends. Yeah. So even if you yourself, you've just had a fight with somebody or somebody who's close to you, imagine your own mental health. You're upset. You don't want the fight to happen. You're feeling guilty. You're angry or whatever you might be feeling. Yeah. Your mental health is getting affected. Your physical health is getting affected. A lot, many times we see people, they start overeating, or they will not eat. Mm. They will, lose sleep, things like that. Physical health starts getting affected. Family health starts getting affected. Being in an Indian context, most of us do live with our families. And then, one person is so upset and not eating and, is crying or something like that. Yeah, the parents will definitely get stressed at what happened and, what is happening. So the family dynamics is getting affected. Research has shown that marital issues and relationship issues are very, very prevalent in getting higher depressive symptoms between people. Okay. Eating disorders, resorting to substance abuse, drinking, smoking, things like that, they start developing after a point. And another major area that we kind of overlook is the children. If they are the parents, so then children get affected, or, siblings will get affected, their parenting needs get affected. Hmm. So, there's a lot that gets affected by one small little conflict which people did not address at the right time.
Yeah.
So it's very, very important to actually, just figure out what the issue was and deal with it, then rather than just let it be for some time and then it'll erupt later.
Yeah. And it's true when you say that, marital issues do cause a lot of issues. As you rightly said, Rajika, the marital issues do cause a lot of mental health issues, and we can even see it in our surroundings. Like, I know my relatives, my mother, my male relatives who have gone through problems because of marital issues. So it's something so, like, now that I am adult and I have understanding of all these things, I can see how prevalent it is amongst our very close relatives. Now that we have developed the understanding of what conflicts are and how they, are impacting so many factors in our life, how do we actually resolve them? What is the resolution strategy for, conflicts in couples, especially millennials, because there are so many millennials, Indian couples now?
Before I resort to what are the optimal ways of resolving these conflicts, I think I want to talk about a little bit about how people usually resolve these issues in everyday life. Huh. There are some typical ways in which people deal with issues that they might be facing when it comes to a relationship.
Yeah.
And those are not always easy.
Yeah.
So it's important to discuss them before we go to the right ways of doing it, or the healthier ways of doing it.
Okay.
So I think the first issue, the way that people deal with the conflict, is always verbal abuse. They'll start shouting or screaming or, blaming each other that you did this and you did that, things like that. Right. So verbal abuse is usually the first thing that people resort to. And unfortunately, the next step then comes to physical abuse. So there are a lot of cases and there are a lot of relationships which resort to physical abuse, even though it is not supposed to be, but it is a sad reality.
And there were so many cases during the pandemic as well, right? The hike.
Yeah. Yeah, there's been, a 30 to 40% hike in the domestic abuse cases in our country because of the pandemic. So, physical abuse, it starts with screaming, shouting, goes on to hitting sometimes. There is another aspect of emotional abuse. You guilt the other person, you gaslight the other person. You just be like, oh, you never don't love me, that's why you're doing this, you don't support me, things like that. So emotionally, your partner. Then in most of our Indian households, it is also financial abuse. Yeah. You know, because sometimes, if not more, one partner would be the one in charge of the finances. And, you know, if you're having a fight and then the partner would just be like, no money. And then, you know, that another leads to a different level of financial abuse. And again, being in an Indian context, the family does get involved. So then, you know, there is also the parents who are getting involved, there are the children who are getting involved. So all of these together are very, very unhealthy ways of dealing with conflicts between couples. So any sort of abuse, be it verbal, physical, emotional, financial, or family involvement, you know, none of them can resort to a healthier relationship or a healthy way of resolving any conflict. So this is what usually people do.
That's true.
And so, you know, now I think given the topic of this conversation, if we look from a psychological perspective on what are these ways of healthy resolving these conflicts.
I was going to ask you the same, you know, like as a psychologist, what is the perspective behind conflicts and how would you, you know, talk about that?
Right. So I personally, in my therapeutic practice, I follow structured reality therapy, which is a form of marital counseling, which is developed again by Dr. William Glasser. And this form of therapy is basically based on two things. The first one is that marriage is a partnership. Okay, it is never you or me. So when I take sessions or when I am dealing with couples, it will never be the boy or the girl or the girl and the girl or the boy or whoever that might be. You know, it is always the relationship that we're addressing, not people on an individual basis.
Right.
So marriage as a partnership is the first ground. And the second is that, you know, we have to shift the focus to what is good for the relationship. We don't have to focus that who did what or what happened or who said what and then what happened and how, you know, ye hua, wo hua, past mein aisa hua, iski wajah se aisa hua. We don't talk about that. So what we have to figure out is how to save the relationship. If the relationship wants any saving, what can you do about it to save the relationship? And that this is about marriage is the partnership. So these are the two areas that we focus on. Mm-hmm. And that's how I can kind of use these areas in my therapy.
Yeah. And how can one do that? What is the technique behind it? How can one execute that in their personal life?
Right. So, you know, I'm just going to give you an example and talk you through these this technique that I use. It is called Big Five Marriage Questions. So, you know, it can be tweaked into Big Five Relationship Questions, Big Five Dating Questions, anything, depending on who we are dealing with.
Right.
So, you know, Seema, the first question that I immediately ask when I get a new client or when we get a new couple is that, do you want to save this relationship?
Okay.
You know,
it's a very important
relationship. It's a very important question. Because if you don't want to stay in that relationship, then there's no point of counseling. Or there's no point of trying to resolve those conflicts. If you've already decided that, you know, I don't want to live with this person anymore. So the conversation kind of ends. So that is the first question that we start with, that, you know, do you want to save this relationship? So whoever is listening to this conversation, if you are going through a conflict and you want to kind of, you know, like answer these questions along with me, and you might get a little bit of clarity. So the first question being, do you want to save it? If you want to save it, if you want to stay with that person, if you do, you know, like want to be in that relationship and continue it. The second question that I always ask is, whose behavior can you actually control? Okay.
And that's so many times ourselves in that case.
Yeah, it is only ourselves, Seema. We can never control another person's behavior.
True.
Right? You cannot be, you always want to, that, you know, I want my boyfriend to love me more, or I want my wife to support me more, and I want my, you know, husband to earn more, or things like that. But in actuality, can you control that? Can you make your husband love you more? No. Can you make your girlfriend be more supportive? No. So, you know, the only person whose behavior you can control is yours. So this realization is very, very important when we are doing relationship counseling. You know, you have to understand that how are your behaviors affecting this relationship, and how are your behaviors affecting this, you know, that couple that you're in, or what is happening. So the second question always is, whose behavior can you control? And we keep dwelling on this question, keep dwelling till the time the people don't answer that it is my own and nobody else's behavior that you can control.
Okay.
And the third question that comes out is, you know, you ask individually to both the partners, is that what is wrong in the relationship currently?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so now here is where the venting starts. And, you know, they're like, oh, he did this and he did that and that happened and so happened.
Yeah.
And, you know, everything under the sun that went wrong.
Right.
So here is the question to vent it out. And to basically the point here is to get everything out in the open. Whatever is bothering them, it is out in the open with the help of this question. So what is wrong? the fourth question is a very interesting one, which says, what is actually good in the relationship? Tell us what's good in your relationship. And if you imagine, be it any relationship, a romantic one or a, you know, family sibling one, when you are upset with somebody, okay, or you know, when you are angry with somebody, it is very difficult to think about the good in that relationship. You know, something good might actually have happened. Of course, they have good qualities because of which you are with them, right? Nobody, you know, everybody has certain good qualities. So here the couple has to dwell on what is good in their marriage. You know, what is the good part? What is the good in their partner? And why? So basically they revisit those times when they decided that I want to be with this person in those ways. So now once they've understood, you know, what is good about the marriage, the last question, the question five that I ask is usually, what is that one thing that you can do in this coming week that will make your relationship stronger? You know, so this question kind of comes up with very different, you know, different creative answers. Somebody says, okay, I'm going to, you know, bake a cake, something like that. Somebody says, I'm going to take her out for a romantic dinner. Somebody says, we're going to go for a movie. And then, you know, then we get some heavy answers where somebody's like, I'm going to work on my trust issues, or I'm going to, you know, like solve my family conflicts or things like that. So this then becomes the homework. So whatever they say that they feel will strengthen their relationship, we work on it. That becomes their homework. They have to work on it, do it, actually do that thing, and then come back. And then we take it from there. So together, when we look at these five questions, you know, it kind of gives a summary of conflict resolution. It kind of like, you know,
You know, these are really good questions. And I think so couples who haven't had that introspection about themselves and themselves as a couple, this is going to be a very revelational journey for them, right? Because having that insight about ourselves, it's always good. And I'm glad, Rajika, you could share these questions with the audience today. And I'm sure it's going to help many, many people. And there's so many of us couples who are sometimes lost, and therapy, especially, you know, relationship counseling can really help in people finding their space, their, you know, vision as a couple. And I'm glad we could do this together and have it, you know, out there for everybody else. So how, you know, we are coming to the end of our conversation today. What are some of the tips that you want to say to couples out there? I mean, we did talk about conflict resolution, which is great. And I think so, your whatever you share was so good, and people are going to find it really helpful. How about other aspects of relationship? What are the tips you want to share with everybody watching right now?
Right. So before I go into some more tips, you know, which are a little more generic in nature, I want to say that these five questions you can apply to any relationship in your life. Be it just couples, be it your parents, be it your siblings, be it your boss, you know, any relationship, friends, family, anybody. And you're having issues with them, answer these questions. Okay, they will give you some sort of clarity, and be honest. Be honest with yourself. And, you know, I hope that these will help with you.
Yeah.
So some basic last tips that I would like to give before we sign off is another cue technique that I use with my clients. So before the pandemic, when I had my office and my setup, I had this circle made. So a normal circle on the ground. And it is big enough to fit two people. And so when the couples used to come in, I used to make them stand in that circle. And we call it the solving circle. So it is a very famous technique. I think you might be knowing it. So it's called the solving circle. And so the logic behind it is that when two people step into that circle, then their relationship is the priority. Then it is not you and me or individual people. It is the marriage. So there are three people actually in that circle, the boy, the partner, and the relationship. And in that circle, they decide on what they will do to save that relationship. So, you know, if you want a time out, you want some space, you don't want to deal with it, you can step out. Okay, always. And take a time and, you know, like discuss and fight. But once you come back into that circle, then the marriage takes the priority. That is your priority, or the relationship takes your priority. And you decide that, okay, this is what I have to do in order to save it. And then you work on it. So instead of just fighting and being like, oh no, you change and you change, or, you know, you do better, or I will not, you know, think like that. Yeah. That circle kind of just gives a perspective that we both have to make this relationship work. Otherwise, it's just going to fall. So that is one
activity. Yeah,
it's a very fun activity.
Yeah,
you know, you can. I would urge all of the people to try it, and then let us know in the comments on whether they tried and whether it helped.
Yeah.
So that is one. Apart from that, there are some very basic, things that I always say. You know, they might just sound very commonsensical, but they're very important. So the first one is obviously to communicate.
Yeah.
You know, please talk out. Please talk your issues. Don't keep it in your heart, or don't just be like, oh, what will that person feel? And I will look weak. So we don't want that. Be direct. Be communicative. Okay. Try not resolving to blame game that, he did that and she did that. And that is why this has happened. It's not going to help. You know, blaming never helps.
Mm-hmm.
So try not blaming. Try communicating. Try to address the issue at that very moment. You know, you can't be like, today something has happened and you talk about it 1 week later. That, oh, you did that and that is what hurt me. It doesn't work. You know, the intensity has gone, the moment has gone, probably the other person has also forgotten it.
Okay.
And, you know, and you'd be like, you are upset and that other the partner doesn't even know that what happened. So try addressing that issue at that very moment. Be respectful. This is something that's very important. You know, your partner is your partner. So you have to be respectful to that partner. You don't have to, like, you know, say things that you will regret later and do things that you will regret later.
Yeah.
So be respectful. Be, you know, you're still in love, or you're still choosing to be together, whatever the fight might be. So be respectful, communicate, be direct, solve those issues. Don't blame. Make a plan. You know, that's what I always say. Make a plan. That if something like this again happens, you know what to do next. You know how to resolve it. So have a plan in place. Take some time out if required. So if you feel that, you know, it's getting too much and you don't want to be with that person for some time, go for a walk, or, you know, go out with your friends, do something. Take a time out, but come back and try to resolve it. Don't just let it go.
Yeah.
And ultimately, obviously, the last one that I'd say is to please try therapy. It really helps. Yeah. Go to a good relationship counselor. You know, try marital counseling or team marital or whatever stage you are in. And I assure you, it will help.
Right. And that's such a sweet note on which, you know, we are bringing this conversation to. The last basic tips, I mean, it's very important to take away that as well as we talk about relationship counseling. This is something that is simple to do and very much in control of our hands, you know, basic things like communicating, addressing the issue, being respectful. And again, Rajika, thank you so much for joining, for, you know, sharing such insightful thoughts on relationship and conflict resolution. I'm glad you can be with us today. And those who want to know more about Rajika, you can find her details in the description, also in the post, and you can reach out to her. And yeah, if you want to know more about relationship counseling, please let us know in the comments. We would like to address that again sometimes in the future. So that's it, Rajika. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for having
me. Yeah, thank you for being on board, and it was delightful to do this conversation with you. Thank you, viewers, for joining in. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to MHT. Thank you so much. Bye.